Welcome. It is obviously very important to protect APIs, the sources of data for your organization, against unauthorized use. You learn how to do that with OAuth access tokens in this video. I'm Ronald Guit for Duende Software, makers of Identity Server. We help you to create secure applications in your organization. Let's dive in. An access token acts as the key to open the API. Without one, there's no way to access it. And the vehicle for the access token is the authorization header in the HTTP request. I've explained the details on how this works and how it is obtained in a previous video. But the access token is more sophisticated than a simple key. It contains information that needs to be verified by the API before it can allow access. In the introduction video, we already saw the structure of a JWT, a JSON web token. It has a header with metadata and a payload that consists of key value pairs. The base64 URL encoded version of that includes a signature and is sent in the authorization header. First, the API should check if this is the expected token type. AT plus JWT identifies the JWT as an access token. There are many other places in OAuth where JWTs are used for other purposes. The AT plus JWT helps disambiguate them. The signature is the way for the API to verify that the token came from the identity provider it trusts, and that it wasn't tampered with along the way. It works by using cryptography with a public-private key pair. To correctly verify the token, the API has to read the part in the header that tells it what signing algorithm was used. This JWT uses an RSA signature with a SHA-256 digest. The API also has to know the ID of the key that was used. Keys are typically rotated on the identity provider. The KID key ID indicates the current key. Payload data is also used to verify the token. Issuer should be checked to see if that corresponds with the identity provider the API trusts, which should be pre-configured. There's also NBF, not before. The current time should be after that and before the timestamp in exp, expiration. Additionally, the scope should be checked to see if it contains an expected value. Now, that's a lot to check, but the good news is that there's no need to do all of that manually. Almost all platforms have built-in support for that, or have libraries available to do it. In ASP.NET Core, the JWT bearer handler can be configured like this. All there is to do, really, is to let it know which issuer, which identity provider to trust, and which token type to expect. Using that information, most of the validating I explained can be done automatically. For signature validation, the API can find out the public key to use by reading the discovery document on the identity provider. For now in these videos, we will only use scopes, and thus we can disable the audience validation. And the map inbound claim setting prevents the middleware from renaming claims in a non-standard way. To configure which endpoint should be protected, the require authorization extension method can be called while configuring the endpoint. Another possibility is to use the authorize attribute, which can also be applied on controller classes and/or their actions. This will check if authentication succeeded in the configured scheme. And since we don't specify a scheme here, the default one is used, which corresponds to the JWT bearer handler. Maybe you noticed that there's still something missing from the validation requirements I outlined a minute ago. The API doesn't check any scopes or claims right now. So if the payload would contain a scope value of API1, for example, that is ignored. In ASP.NET Core, authorization policies are used for that. They can be written by calling addPolicy on the options object that is provided by addAuthorization. The method takes two parameters. The first is the name of the policy. It can be anything you want. And the second is a function that gets a policy object on which the rules for this policy can be configured. And here we require a scope with the value API1. Now the policy can be applied by specifying it as a parameter to require authorization or to the authorize attribute. Multiple policies can be created that check for other scopes. This API works with scopes for read-only access and full access, for example. Also, user claims can be checked as part of the policy, in addition or instead of the scope checks. If needed, multiple policies can be applied to endpoints easily. Defining a fallback policy is recommended. This is a policy that is applied for all endpoints that don't have authorization configured with the require authorization call or the authorize attribute. This will help against incidentally unprotected endpoints. A default policy is for endpoints that have either the call or the attribute, but no explicit policy is passed as an argument. In this case, we make it equal to the fallback policy to make sure the API scope is always required, no matter which endpoint is called. And that was it for this video. See you in the next one.